Broadcasting all over the world at urbanbroadcastmedia.com. Delivering love and inspiration
24/7.
This is UBM Pretty. The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
A young man that you all know is Joe the Policeman from the What's Going Down episode of That's My Mama. I want you to put your hands together and welcome him to the stage. Big round of applause.
I said Walter Jones.
Who is it?
I said Walter Jones.
What's his name?
I said Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
I said Walter Jones.
Who is it?
I said Walter Jones.
Say it again.
I said Walter Jones.
Who are you with?
I said Walter Jones.
One more game.
Sir Walter Jones.
The Sir Walter Jones Show with co-host Alvin Carter. We are a Christian talk show in which we tackle all the hot topics in a believer's walk. It's Theology Thursday. If you love the Word of God, grab your Bibles and let's see what thus saith the Lord. Join Elder Jones and Pastor Carter in some good old-fashioned Bible study.
All right. So now you go to David Barton's website or you read one of his books and you might find an image of John Adams, and out to the side it says, "The Christian religion is above all the religions that ever prevailed or existed in ancient or modern times. John Adams, signer of the Declaration," and so on. Okay? And now Christians go to Barton's website and they read his materials and they see a quote like that, and of course David Barton is not going to tell them that John Adams denied the reality of the Holy Ghost. David Barton is not going to tell him that Adams blasphemed God and said that the idea that Jesus is God manifest in the flesh is an awful blasphemy that needs to be got rid of. He's basically saying that we need to get rid of the gospel. He's saying the same thing Thomas Jefferson said. They both said we need to get rid of the gospel. And Thomas Paine said the same thing. You've got three founders who all three openly said in their declarations, we need to get rid of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And yet David Barton doesn't even blush to present this guy in a church and make it look like and sound like that he was some kind of Christian. And you will also find Thomas Jefferson on Barton's website. And one of the quotes that he has from Jefferson, Jefferson says, "I am a real Christian, that is to say, a disciple of the doctrines of Jesus Christ. I am a Christian in the only sense in which he wished anyone to be," right? Thomas Jefferson, and so on. Now, what Jefferson is saying in that quote, when he says, "I am a real Christian," what he means, brethren, is he means you are not real Christians if you believe that Jesus is the Son of God. You're not a real Christian if you believe that he was born of a virgin and that he died on the cross for your sins and that God raised him from the dead and that by faith in him you have salvation and eternal life. Oh, you're not real Christians if you believe that. You're dupes. You're believing stupidity and falsehood and imposture, to use Jefferson's own words about the teachings of the gospel. And you're not a real Christian if you believe that. Jefferson's saying, "I am a real Christian because I don't believe that stuff. I am a real Christian because I don't believe Jesus is the Son of God." That's what he's saying. And so as God says in the scripture that even the offering of the wicked is abomination in his sight, so is this confession, a so-called confession from Thomas Jefferson. It's really an abomination, because what he's doing is, by that, he's mocking the gospel, and he's mocking those who believe the gospel. And it's shameful that somebody like David Barton would present quotes from Thomas Jefferson like this and separate them from the full context of who Jefferson was.
The view of Jefferson and John Adams was much like that of the ancient Jews that opposed Christ. When Jesus said to them, "I and my Father are one," They took up stones to stone him. The scripture says, Jesus answered them, Many good works have I showed you from my Father. For which of those works do you stone me? The Jews answered him, saying, For a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy, and because that thou, being a man, makest thyself God. In the same way, Adams and Jefferson did not object to the good work that Jesus did, or to his example of morality. But concerning the doctrine that Jesus is God manifest in the flesh, as the Bible clearly teaches, at this they were incensed, and like the Pharisees of old, wanted him got rid of.
They were very much like the Sadducees 2,000 years ago, who did not believe in miracles or angels or the supernatural. That was very much the thinking of Thomas Jefferson and John Adams, and really the whole Enlightenment movement that was taking place over in Europe. Well, when David Barton was on the Glenn Beck program, probably the biggest misquote and misrepresentation of history that he's done is this quote from John Adams about the Holy Ghost. And he uses this on the Glenn Beck program, and then I'm going to show it to you again when he uses it in a church, when he's doing a church presentation. Here, look.
And then this thing was the dream from God. This is John Adams' quote right here. He's talking to Benjamin. He says, But my friend Benjamin, there's something very serious in this business. He said, The Holy Ghost carries on the whole Christian system and his truth. Not a baptism, not a marriage, not a sacrament can be administered but by the Holy Ghost. And he goes through this theological thing that...
I don't know if you've ever seen one of John Adams' letters. I brought one just in case you might want to see one. This letter right here from John Adams. He brought this to Benjamin Rush, his friend, signer of the Declaration, signed on the back by John Adams here. But I want you to see the kind of stuff that John Adams would write in his letters. I've got the letter up here where you can see it. You see the letter? I'm going to read from the bottom paragraph right there. And you may see where the arrow is pointing. It says, The Holy Ghost. Look what John Adams declares in this letter. He says, The Holy Ghost carries on the whole Christian system in his truth. Not a baptism, not a marriage, not a sacrament can be administered but by the Holy Ghost. He says, There is no authority, civil or religious. There can be no legitimate government but what is administered by the Holy Ghost. There can be no salvation without it. All without is rebellion and perdition, or in more orthodox words, damnation. I don't think I saw that on the HBO special.
While David Barton cuts this quote short, the full context of Adams' letter reveals that he was in no way supporting the authority of the Holy Ghost, but was rather denying it, and even mocked it as the orthodox belief of Christians. As we showed earlier, Adams was a well-known Unitarian and did not even believe the Holy Ghost existed. How David Barton, who has such a vast knowledge of the Founding Fathers, could have overlooked this, we can only wonder. Beginning where Adams left off, the actual letter reads, There is no authority, civil or religious. There can be no legitimate government, but what is administered by this Holy Ghost. There can be no salvation without it. All without it is rebellion and perdition, or in more orthodox words, damnation. Although this is all artifice and cunning, yet they all believe it so sincerely that they would lie down their lives under the axe or the fiery faggots for it. Alas, the poor, weak, ignorant dupe, human nature. There is so much kingcraft, priestcraft, and devil's craft in the world that it seems a desperate and impractical project to undeceive it. What makes Barton's misquote so awful is that Adams and Jefferson often wrote to each other about the God of nature and nature's laws, by which they meant the understanding about God that could be perceived by the natural man, in rejection of things that are supernatural or miraculous, which they believed was superstition and foolishness. This is why Jefferson wrote about the pretensions of those who say that Jesus suspended and reversed the laws of nature at will by performing miracles, which Jefferson believed was not credible because it was contrary to reason. In other words, the laws of nature suggest that miracles are simply not possible. Therefore, they believed that our understanding of God should be limited to only what we can prove through nature. This is what they meant by nature's God and the God of nature. These references are intended to specifically reject the claims of a supernatural God in the Bible. In fact, John Adams was so against the idea of the Holy Ghost that he believed the whole concept of world government was really a struggle between mankind versus the Christian belief in heavenly authority.
Say what?
The Word of God is powerful, often misunderstood, but with proper study, you can gain accurate application of this potent source of life here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Welcome to the Sir Walter Jones Show. I am he, Sir Walter Jones. And it is Thursday, Theology Thursday, and we're talking about a very interesting topic. I'm going to just go a little solo today here. I got my tea ready, got my articles and my Bible ready, and we're just ready to go into Political Science 101. Where is God in America? Yeah, absolutely. We are not going to put our right hand on our hearts today. Not at all. Where is God in America? Where is he? Y'all heard a little statement about the fiery faggots in that that little opening piece there. Some of you who don't know nothing about history might have giggled at it, but you go to Google or wherever you find your resources from. A faggot was, it became a cigarette, but it pretty much was the sticks on fire. That's all it was. We use terms. That's why the English language is so confusing at times, because its meaning change over time. Others from different nations try to learn our language, and they say it's just so hard because you guys have so many rules and regulations in your language, and they just can't get it. But today we're going to talk about, where's God in America? Is the United States a Christian nation? We're going to answer these questions. Is the United States a Christian nation? And if so, why are there almost 500,000 churches in America? You realize there are almost, and each year it gets higher and higher, 500,000 in America alone. But yet, the United States seems like they're more or less Christian than ever before. Let's talk about that. It's this topic today is from a young man who I love and adore. He's my Kojic brother in the gospel, from Facebook, Jay Humphrey. And I usually ask people if they want to submit some suggestions for the Sir Walter Jones Show. Sometimes it's me by myself, but a lot of times it's me and Alvin Carter. He's not here. We've been saying for the past couple of days that his mom had a stroke Sunday and almost took her out. But the grace of God is keeping her alive. She's breathing. She's stable. And yesterday we did a tribute show to Richard Smallwood, to his music. And to all of the things that he wrote in his music that impacted us. We call it the Richard Smallwood Effect. Go to Facebook, go to Spreaker.com, and the show was up. And while we were playing that show and listening to his songs, his album's mom opened her eyes right there in the hospital room. It was just an amazing night we had last night. So he's still with his mom. And so today I'm going to go a little solo here. But Jay Humphrey says, I'd like to submit to you a show topic. I'd love to hear you guys discuss, as you do so well. Thank you, brother, by the way. You may have already done so. If so, tell me the episode so that I can check it out. So I have been writing this piece as I am led to do, dealing with the effects of the separation of church, the separation of state from church is what he's saying here. It really seems to me that much of the problem in the world, but at minimum in the States, is that the church has been boxed out of its rightful place in politics and policy, and has allowed the government to be run from a highly dominated secular worldview. Churches have become satisfied in this position because, let's face it, less obligation on their part, and those swell tax breaks all feel so good. Yet it has lost its voice and seat at the table on many issues. More organizations have been birthed and are doing the work of outreach, real ministry. Outside of the church structure and are more involved in community and society, and in many cases have more influence than the body because of their presence in communities. And of course, outreach has all but diminished as a result. He says, I may be reaching, but I'm really looking at the state of the church, in the capitalized state, which is the title of a piece that he's writing. And he asked me about an episode. And so we're going to deal with this in a two-part series. Today we're going to talk about the state more so than the church. Tomorrow we're going to talk about more so the church. I don't know what to call tomorrow's show just yet, but I want to bring in the law of man, the law of God, tomorrow if I can. But I'm going to ask the question today, where is God in America? Where did he go? Is he hiding under a rock? Or did y'all put him under a rock? If you heard the soundbite I gave, it was a full, I don't know, about 8-9 minutes. It talks about our founders, the one who penned the wonderful document we call Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. Okay, it's from Adullam Films. You can go there and watch the DVD yourself. I watched it in its entirety. It's about 2-3 hours, and it's power packed, full of information that you may agree or you may not agree. It's up to you. Adullam Films. You can go to adullamfilms.com if you want to. But it's called The Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers. It says The Hidden Faith of the Founding Fathers is perhaps the first and only document to go where no film has ever gone before. And they are definitely right about that after watching it. Confronting the little known beliefs about our American founders. Now, we're going to go into some very controversial stuff today. All right. Stuff that you guys never heard. Some of you probably heard, but you didn't hear it in the way Sir Walter Jones put it, because, you know, I was birthed out of some wild seed. conservative Christian leaders often claim that the revolutionaries were godly men who were trying to build a Christian nation. But was their faith the true faith of the Bible, or is it possible that the exact opposite is true? So the real questions are, what did the founding fathers believe about Jesus Christ? Christianity begins with faith in the person of Christ himself. What did the fathers or the founders think of Christ? And what did they think of the gospel? Were they fighting for Christianity or were they against it? And I'm going to delve into them, their letters. I'm going to play some sound bites. I'm going to read parts of the Constitution. And we're going to find out what's going on in their minds, because it's all about the wording, people. So in that soundbite, if you watch the DVD, you will come up, you'll find out these, I have about 5 or 6 points that comes out of this DVD. Number one, the faith of Thomas Paine. Now, these people that I'm going to call out, you've heard their names in school through your history books, your teachers, your history teachers, and they've told you about them, and you've had to learn. Those of us who were, back in the day in the 70s and the 80s, we had to learn certain things that I guess the curriculum is kind of changing now, where we don't, you know, the students today don't really have to learn what we had to learn back then. And something is falling by the wayside. We don't even know our origins, although we live here in America. And it's amazing. They have foreigners to learn the laws of our land, but we who are born and raised here, it's like we don't have to know it. So number one, the faith of Thomas Paine in this DVD says that the man who inspired the American Revolution, that's right, y'all, Thomas Paine, go ahead and Google it, and the writings of the Declaration of Independence. This film shows how Paine's influence over the Revolution was critical, while his anti-Christian writings revealed much of what the other founders truly believed. The fathers of this nation, many of them were anti-Christian. Yes, they were. The second point is the faith of Thomas Jefferson. OMG, Thomas Jefferson. Y'all love him. Author of the Declaration of Independence. Jefferson said the Book of Revelation was the ravings of a maniac, and that the teachings of Jesus and the apostles were full of imposter and stupidity. After his... Mm-hmm. After his private papers were published, he was called the reviler of Christ by a leading clergyman. That was Thomas Jefferson. And I'm telling y'all, he did some crazy things and said some crazy stuff. My third point is the faith of Benjamin Franklin. Whew. Y'all love y'all some, this guy with a, when y'all see Benjamin, y'all see a guy flying a kite with a key on it. Okay. Well, the only man to sign all of the original founding documents, Benjamin Franklin, was part of a radical occult group called the Hellfire Club. This is not some conspiracy theorist. This is stuff that you can get yourself, readily available, papers of their own writings, readily available at the Library of Congress. He was part of the Hellfire Group in England that took part in the satanic rituals, which may have included human sacrifices. Shortly before he died, he openly stated that he did not believe the gospel.
Oh, no.
Absolutely. I mean, he loved orgies. That was Benjamin Franklin, the man you guys love so dearly. My fourth point person is the faith of John Adams, the second president of the United States. The evidence shows that Adam was no Christian at all, but rather exalted pagan beliefs about God while abhorring the gospel. He called it an awful blasphemy. That's right. The second president of the United States, who you all love so dearly. My fifth point is the faith of George Washington. Uh-oh. Don't nobody mess with George Washington. Don't nobody talk about George. Now, George, they wanted George to be called, they wanted him to be a king. And thank God for some morality in George Washington. He says, no, we just come from that mess. I don't want to be a king. I want to be a president. Known as the father of our country, three of Washington's own pastors. Okay, I'll say this again. Three of Washington's own pastors doubted his faith in Christ. Proof is shown that he went to war not for Christianity, but for the universal system that would embrace all religions. When compelled by the clergy to confess his faith in Christ, Washington says, I will not. Lord have mercy. Facebook is chiming in. They're going there. Art says, he said he upset he not here. He says he been telling people this for years. Religion was a tool to keep the less educated in check. Jay Humphrey is on Facebook. He's chiming in. This is his fault. So if I'm getting in any trouble, blame Jeff. Jay Humphrey. I changed his name. I said Jeff. He said, man, I was hoping you all would be on as well because I look forward to hearing your comments. he likes the trio of us. Yeah, we are monsters. Okay, and so the sixth thing that I want to say is Washington and the Jesuits. Okay, y'all say, who are the Jesuits? Well, this new pope is a Jesuit, believe it or not. He's a Jesuit. Generally unknown is the role of Rome and the Jesuit order in the American Revolution. Powerful historical evidence shows that George Washington worked with the Jesuits to prevail against their common enemy, England. This information is groundbreaking and documented beyond any doubt. But the seventh point, the biblical worldview, confronts the idea that suggested that the founders were deists or agnostics, whereas, according to the Bible, they were neither deists or agnostics. They were antichrists. Dun, dun, dun. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. I just got in big trouble there. Okay. These men of so-called, y'all call them men of God. And again, the reason why some of you are listening to this show right now and disagreeing with me heavily is because you haven't read it for yourself.
I'm going to pray for you.
Yes. God leaves imprints. He leaves his fingerprints behind in creation. All you got to do is read Romans 1, and he tells you, I left it there. Matter of fact, when I created you, I put it in you. You knew the truth at birth. He said it in Romans 1, okay? So that you now, and then you open your eyes, and you look up, and you see me. I left my DNA, all right? These founding fathers of our nation left their footprints in letters. They believed in writing letters. They wrote a lot of letters, and they're left for us to read. OK, and so the reason why you don't know is because you refuse to go to a free place called the Internet. And another free place before the Internet is called the Library of Congress. You walk in there And you have the right to look at all of that information. It's yes. right in your face. You may not be able to touch it, but they have, they took a picture of it and they put it on a thingy and then you can scroll through it. Okay. All right. I'm going to play this file here called How Religious Were the Founding Fathers? I'm just want to continue to give you just more proof from others who have walked and talked, not with the leaders, because then they'd be dirt old, but they were able to take the original documents and read them for themselves, and then they gave their viewpoints on it. This file called How Religious Were the Founding Fathers?
Fora TV. The world is thinking.
What role did the Judeo-Christian thought contribute to the formation of our Republican experiment?
Well, people would have talked about Christianity more, but it was the Old and New Testament. So in that sense, you could say it was Judeo-Christian thought. It was, of course, very, very important, although not so much from the founders. Most of them were not, emotionally religious. Some of them were really anti-religious, like Jefferson. He hated organized religion. Now, he got burned a couple of times by making some statements that suggested that he didn't think religion was all that important. And that hurt him in the election of 1800. And so he said, well, I'm going to show myself and some of my close friends that I really am a good Christian. And he cut up the Bible, as you know, and created the Jefferson Bible. What he did was just cut up all those phrases that Jesus used, saying, love thy neighbor as thyself, which is he thought was the central moral message of Jesus, made him the greatest moralist who ever lived. But he did not believe in the divinity of Jesus. Divinity of Christ, and that was true of Adams and many others. Washington never spoke much about religion, but he never was much of he didn't have any emotional connection to religion. He went to church, but when the minister complained that he wasn't taking communion, he decided not to go on communion Sundays. He just wasn't going to. And he never kneeled in his Episcopal church, which is common in the Episcopal church, kneeling, and he didn't do that. And of course, he never called for a minister upon his death. So he was not, but the people were. Now, you have to understand that most ordinary Americans in 1776 and into the early Republic were terribly religious, very religious. And they were, as the society became more democratic, they brought their religiosity with them, and that's where you get the evangelical outpouring in the early 19th century. You know, prior to the Revolution, say in 1760, there were no Methodists in America. By 1790, the Methodists were the second fastest growing. They were the largest denomination, second largest denomination. The Baptists had taken over, but the Methodists were coming so fast that by 1810, the Methodists were the largest denomination in America. Now think of that. From 1760, there's no Methodists, and in 1810, they are the largest group. That was a phenomenal outpouring of religiosity from ordinary people as they brought their religious feelings to the fore. So as America became more democratic, which it did in the decades following the Revolution, the evangelicals took over. Now, Jefferson was out of touch. As late as 1820, he thought there was not a single person now alive, he says, who won't die a Unitarian. Think of it, a Unitarian. How wrong could he be? Well, this is when the Baptists and the Methodists are taking over the culture, the religious culture, and a good part of the culture as a whole. And so the founders were left behind, in a sense, by their own democratizing of the governments and the culture, and the people rose up and brought their religion with them.
Yeah, I'm gonna get to this break here. The people of the United States, they were very religious, but the founders, I'm gonna go into that. Alvin Carter's chiming in. He said Washington was a Mason. He was, but you know how many Christians who say they're Christians who don't believe. Yeah, I want to hear from the Clark Sisters. They got a song called Pray for the USA from their Heart of Soul project on the Rejoice label, a division of World Records, 1984. The Clark Sisters, Pray for the USA. So, Brother John Show.
Log on to urbanbroadcastmedia.com and check out the many services Urban Broadcast Media provides. Whether it's social media, video production, radio broadcasting, or audio recording, we got you covered.
Why are women so happy about new Tickle antiperspirant? Is it because Tickle is the first roll-on with a big, wide ball?
Yes!
Is it because Tickle comes in four fresh fragrances? Or is it because Tickle helps keep you dry all day? Make yourself happy. Staying drier is nicer with a little Tickle.
Look what happens when you buy three boxes of Purina Cat Chow. You get one box free.
Purina Cat Chow. Chow, chow, chow.
Buy three bags of Purina Cat Chow and get a coupon good for one bag free.
Purina Cat Chow. Chow, chow, chow.
No matter what size you buy, you can mail in proofs of purchase and get a coupon good for one free.
Purina Cat Chow. Chow, chow, chow.
So, buy any three Purina Cat Chow now and get one free.
Chow, chow, chow.
Hey, this is Julie Norwood with 60 seconds of cool inspiration for your day. In life, it's really easy to get bogged down. We get bogged down because we forget we're on a journey to see our Father. What you see is not where you belong. Look to heaven. Remember heaven. Keep heaven right in front of you. This will help you keep everything in perspective. This life is temporary, even in the ministry. This is not your home. Remember that. Your battles won't be such a big deal when you know that where you are is not where you belong for any longer than a season. Embrace where you are for a greater purpose. Embrace this life and all that it affords you, an expectation of heaven. That's 60 seconds of cool inspiration with Julie Norwood. For more inspiration, check out my webpage, julienorwood.com. God loves you, and He has an awesome plan for your life.
That's right!
The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
Hi, ho, and welcome back.
Welcome back.
The Word of God is powerful, often misunderstood, but with proper study, you can gain accurate application of this potent source of life here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Thursday. Thursday.
Speak, Lord.
Speak to me.
Speak to me.
Speak, Lord.
Oh, speak, Lord.
Sir Walter Jones Show. I'm back. Speak to me. Speak, Lord. I was so blind. Now I can see. Oh, so lost. Until you spoke to me. She need to let me know ahead of time what she going to say. Yeah, we're talking about where's God in America. Where is He? The Fox News says, pray for the USA. We need it. We definitely do need it. I'm upsetting some people about our forefathers. And then some of them are saying, thank you. You're finally telling the truth. Something that I've always known about. You know, I tell this story a lot where I go about how to find out if someone is telling you the truth and how to spot a phony from the real McCoy. And I was talking about how last year we had a really bad winter and how the mice began to come from out of the streets into your homes because it was too cold for them to build burrows for their babies. And they would come and show up in y'all's houses. They was coming into my, I have an enclosed back porch, and they would come in. Somehow they found a way to breach in, come on in. And I would hear them, but I didn't see them that much. And then what we did was we went to the store, Walmart, and bought some Decon rat poison and put some of that rat poison down, opened the box and put it down there and let them have a great delicatessen. By the end of that winter, I think I've killed about 25 mice. In my house. It was amazing.
Oh, no.
How I might see one or two, but over a period of weeks, about 25 were dead. And I said to myself, what is in that poison that can possibly wipe out all those mice? And I turned the box around and I saw the ingredients on the box. And it said that it was 95% good food. But then it said it had 5% poison in it. And it gave me, you know, we preachers, we come up with a message on everything we see. And it told me that 95%, they have to pump 95% good food in there because that's the only thing that will attract the mice and the rats. We are attracted to the good stuff, the stuff that might be, when you hear terms, and I'm going to go there because I'm going to bring Oprah up in this show in a minute. Okay. I'm going to bring out some terms that you guys have heard, but you don't know the meaning of it. They pumped 95% good food to attract the rat, but 5% of the ingredient killed. It only took 5% to kill these rats. And that's the way Satan works in America. He will give you a lot of truth. He told Adam and Eve in the garden a lot of truth. The enemy knows that you know a lot of truth, or he tells you the truth, but he's only going to give you a couple of percentages of falseness, and he hides that. It's like subliminal messages, you know. That's how a lot of people get caught up into these occults, because Jim Jones was preaching the word of God. He sure was. He was beating that Bible on that pulpit, and a lot of us was running to that church. And then behind curtains, he said, "I'm going to sleep with your wife today." Okay. Oh, okay, Jim Jones, because, you know, you sure is a man of God. Well, okay. And then tomorrow I'm going to sleep with your son. Oh, okay, Jim Jones. I mean, it that's how literal and how horrible it was that we can be deceived by many. The founding fathers of the Constitution wrote specific words in there to get you to see or to win you over in a way, but you didn't really know their background. It appears that their background was holy, and they were men of God, but they were men of God, but they were men of lower G. I'll go there in a minute. Is there a separation of church and state? Yes and no. Many churches have what's called a 501c3. That gives you the right says that I don't have to pay these taxes, okay? And there's some rights and privileges that are given to not-for-profit organizations who carry that 501c3. Who gives you that 501c3? The government. Mm-hmm. And when the government gives you something, guess what? You are held by the rules and regulations of that. That's why I don't allow certain people to give me certain things. I don't. Because if I allow them to do these things for me, then they get bragging rights, and then they begin to tell everybody what I did for them. And then that sense of you belong to me, or you owe me something. I live in South Dakota, where the Native Americans are very proud people. Okay. And we've talked about some of their struggle, but they have a monument down there called Crazy Horse, which is twice or more larger than Mount Rushmore. Those four presidents that are up there. And they've been building the Crazy Horse Monument since the 1950s. One guy started building it, and then he brought his family in. They started building it. And the government says, "We will give you some money to help you finish this monument." And the Native Americans said, "No, no, this is us. You've done enough damage to us. That's why we're in the state that we're in." If y'all have never heard of the Trail of Tears, go to Google, go to YouTube. And it will actually make you cry. Andrew Jackson, one of the presidents, wanted to annihilate, is that the word? The Native Americans. Genocide. He wanted to get rid of all of them. Destroy them. I think he's on a $20 bill. Mm-hmm. Okay. I had a $20 bill in my pocket. And I think I was making a transition with a Native American in Chicago, in South Dakota. I can't remember what the transition was, and I had given him the 20. He says, "No, can you give me 2 tens?" I said, "Why?" He said, "Because of that man on that dollar, on that $20 bill." I mean, that's how much hurt is in those people. Okay. And so is there a separation of church and state? We're going to talk about it more probably tomorrow, but we're going to dig just a little bit into it today to find out. How is there separation of church and state when every time you turn around, well, look at the government, look at the buildings, the Capitol building, look at the look on the headstones, the Ten Commandments is in there. Look at Moses and all of those deities that are on the outside walls of our governmental buildings. You see a lot of church in it. Okay, our freedom has cost us greatly. It really has. I have a file here that some of you have saw on Facebook, and I want you to hear a interaction between Minister Farrakhan and Mike Wallace. Okay, I'm not a Farrakhan follower, but if anybody tell the truth, I'm gonna sit there and listen to him. I can examine what his life is, but if he tell the truth, I'll say amen. Okay, and when he's not telling the truth, I shut up. But Minister Farrakhan said something very shocking to Mike Wallace. And if you could see the video, you see the look on Mike Wallace of shock and awe, because he could not believe First of all, he made a mistake and said what he said, and Farrakhan laid it into him. I felt so bad for Mike Wallace, although I really didn't. Let's hear that file.
If I went to Israel, I don't think Israel would be the best place for me to be at this time, considering the view that most Jews have of Louis Farrakhan.
You go to Nigeria, which is, if not the most corrupt nation in Africa, and it is, it could be the most corrupt nation in the world, Minister Farrakhan.
Oh, now, Mr. Wallace.
It is the most corrupt nation that I have ever covered. I've been there 25 years ago, and I've been there as recently as last year.
Fine. So what? 35 years old. That's what that nation is. Now, here's America, 226 years old. You love democracy, but there in Africa, you're trying to force these people into a system of government that you just have accepted 30 years ago. Black folk got the right to vote. You're not in any moral position to tell anybody how corrupt they are. You should be quiet and let those of us who know our people go there and help them get out of that condition. But America should keep her mouth shut wherever there's a corrupt regime, as much hell as America has raised on the earth. No, I will not allow America or you, Mr. Wallace, to condemn them as the most corrupt nation on earth when you have spilled the blood of human beings. Has Nigeria dropped an atomic bomb and killed people in Hiroshima and Nagasaki? Have they killed off millions of Native Americans? How dare you put yourself in that position as a moral judge? I think you should keep quiet, because with that much blood on America's hands, you have no right to speak. I will speak, because I don't have that blood on my hands. Yes, there's corruption there. Yes, there's mismanagement of resources. Yes, there is abuse. There's abuse in every nation on earth, including this one. So let's not play holy to moralize on them. Let's help them.
I'm not moralizing. I'm asking a question, and I got an answer.
Why would you put it as the most corrupt regime in the world? That doesn't make sense.
Can you think of one more corrupt?
Yeah, I'm living in one. I'm living in one. Yes. You've done a hell of a thing on this earth, so you should not be the one to talk. You should be quiet when it comes to moral condemnation, in my judgment. I didn't mean to be so fiery.
No, no, that's good. That's good.
That's my passion.
Ta-da!
He said, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to spit in your face. He told him, be quiet. He told him, you don't have a right. Shut up and let me talk. Yeah. There was a lot of truth on what Farrakhan was saying there. America is the number one murderers in the world. We have murdered more people than any nation in history. Okay. We have more people in jail. We're the most incarcerated nation in the world. Okay. But again, where did it all come from? It all comes from our freedom. Our freedom have cost us greatly. And because we are a very free nation, we have to defend that freedom. And I'm going to talk about this because then we go into the military situations here. Okay. Again, this is not a mom and pop bubblegum show today. It's one of those things. See, I can talk like this when the other guys are not here. The Hebrews were under Roman rule. The Hebrews were under Roman rule. Yet they were allowed to keep their laws and customs. Okay. They were. Because when Jesus went through what he went through, they kept throwing it back to the Jews. But the Jews were throwing it back to the state. Okay? This was the United States and its leaders. Okay? Religious tolerance were our forefathers. It was religious tolerance. But you're going to have to listen very closely to the wording in the documents. You will never see the name Jesus in any of it. None of it. They believed in God, just like we say, God bless America. But you notice when the towers fell, you didn't hear America saying, Jesus bless America. Not a one time. You heard God bless. Why? Because God, the name God, can mean anything to anybody. And I'm going to go deep into this. Drafted by Thomas Jefferson between June 11 and June 28, 1776, the Declaration of Independence is at once the nation's most cherished symbol of liberty and Jefferson's most enduring document. Here is an exalted and unforgettable phrase. Jefferson expressed to the he expressed the convictions in the minds and hearts of the American people. The political philosophy of the Declaration was not it wasn't really new, because y'all know where he came from. Its ideals of individual liberty had already been expressed by John Locke, the continental philosopher. So what Jefferson did was to summarize this philosophy in this word you hear, self-evident truths. Again, be very careful on how you read a document. Read it slowly, like you do when you sign in that lease, or when you sign in that that car lease, or when you buy a house. Notice the terminology. He says self-evident truths, and set forth a list of grievances against the king in order to justify before the world the breaking of ties between the colonies and the mother country. Okay. I have a copy of the Declaration, and I want to kind of read this here. And some of you never read the Declaration of Independence. You never once read it. And y'all, some of y'all are 40, 50 years old. You never read it. Okay. July 4th, 1776, you wait to July 4th to pop your firecrackers, and you have no idea why you popping it. You don't. Matter of fact, why are you even celebrating it on the 4th of July? Why? You ask the average African-American why he celebrated 4th of July. He cannot tell you why. He can't tell you why. And he'll throw out some weak little terms about, yeah, that's our Declaration of Independence from what? Okay. So here it is in Congress, July 4, 1776, the unanimous declaration of the 13th United States of America. When in the course of human events, now I need you to pay attention to some of these humanistic terms. We're going to bring them up. Human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with each other, with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature, that's a clue right there, and the natures God entitled them, that's a clue. A decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. Okay, we hold these truths to be self-evident right there. That is, I want you to highlight that. That all men were created equal. Now, when you're seeing these, terms, it sounds like the Bible to many of you. Again, decon, rat poison. That all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their creator. Those of you who watched the Noah movie when it came out, notice that they never used the word God in the movie. They used the word creator. They took God out of that whole entire movie. They did not. Okay. That they are endowed by their creator with certain inalienable rights. Highlight that word, please. That among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Those three right there. Life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. Again, they're winning you guys over. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any formal government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem more likely to affect their safety and happiness. Okay? This is a secular document, everybody. That's all this is. Prudence, indeed, will dictate that governments long established should not be changed for light and transient causes, and accordingly all experience has shown that mankind are more disposed to suffer while evils are sufferable than to right themselves by abolishing the form to which they are accustomed. But when a long strain of abuses and usurpations pursuing invariably the same object evidences a design to reduce them under absolute despotism. Big words. It is their right, it is their duty to throw off such government and to provide new guards for their future security. Such has been the patient sufferance of these colonies. And such is now the necessity which constrains them to alter their former system of government. The history of the present king of Great Britain is a history of repeated injuries and usurpations, all having in direct object the establishment of an absolute tyranny over these states. To prove this, let facts be submitted to a candid world. And then what they did was they itemized all of the things they hated about the king and what he did. Yeah, y'all don't even know this. I'm not gonna read them all because there's a lot of things. It's like remember when Martin Luther went to the temple, the Catholic Church, and he stamped those theses or whatever you call it, talking about all the things that the Catholic Church was doing that he would disagree with, and that's what they did here in the Declaration of Independence. He has refused to ascend to laws the most wholesome and necessary for the public good. He has forbidden his governors to pass laws of immediate and pressing importance. He has refused to pass other laws for the accommodation of large districts of people. I mean, the list goes on and on. He has dissolved representative houses repeatedly. He has obstructed the administration of justice. He has made judges depending on the will of alone. And so it goes on and on and on. And then it's signed by these men who you guys call great. Representatives from Georgia, North Carolina, South Carolina, Massachusetts, Maryland, Virginia, Pennsylvania, Delaware, New York, New Jersey, New Hampshire, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut, New Hampshire. All right. And some of these names y'all know. It's John Adams. I see Samuel Adams. And I'm not talking about the drink. You got John Witherspoon. I'm not talking about the actor or the producer. Okay. Let's see. I see if I can find some other names here. George Taylor, Benjamin Franklin from Pennsylvania. Y'all know these names. Thomas Nelson from Virginia. Thomas Jefferson from Virginia. These are men who signed, and everybody know John Hancock, and that's what, when you hear John Hancock, you think about someone, you know, there's the old saying, put your John Hancock on it. That's what, yeah, yes, your signature, absolutely. Yeah, yeah. So if you notice the language in this document, notice the language, okay? It was not spiritual language whatsoever. It's a secular document. And so if you're going to talk about separation of church and state, this is it right here. This wasn't about the church. It really wasn't. This was about politics. That's all the Declaration of Independence was. It was not about freedom of religion in a sense. It was more of a political, secular type situation. Somebody asked, why isn't the president helping the churches and talking about morality and what have you? Well, he's the president. Is his job a spiritual job or was it a political job? I know I heard a lot of Christians say, man, he's not doing this for this. He's not talking about morality. Well, look at the United States. Look at our setup. What is the job of the president? Is it his job to be moral? To help America be moral? Well, he should be. It's 5:00 in the Chicago area. I'm going even deeper there because we're going to bring Oprah in this thing and we're going to talk about the setup of the United States. Are we a republic? Are we a democratic situation? We're going there. 5:00, I want to hear some Stevie Wonder. He's asked a question. Well, no, he made a statement. You need to have a talk with God. From the Songs of the Key of Life, have a talk with God. Stevie Wonder. Enjoy. I'll be right back. Sir Walter Jones Show.
Broadcasting all over the world at urbanbroadcastmedia.com. Delivering love and inspiration 24/7. This is UBM Praise.
There are people who have let the problems of today lead them to conclude for them life is not the way. But every problem has an answer, and if yours you cannot find, you should talk it over to him. He'll give you peace of mind. When you feel your life's too hard,
Express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
And now, our feature presentation.
The Word of God is powerful, often misunderstood, but with proper study, you can gain accurate application of this potent source of life. Here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
If I were you, I would say,
speak, Lord.
Speak, Lord. Speak to me. Because I need it today, right now. Ooh, I'm in so much trouble today. I keep losing my elder's license, and then I keep losing my citizenship. I think, what is that, the division of your government that comes in and grabs you and deports you? Nationalization, I think they call it. Yeah, they coming for me. They about to deport me back to Africa, place I've never been.
Immigration?
Okay, that one. Jay Humphrey says, to go a little deeper and in line with the topic, when the state divorced the church, they not only divorced the religiosity that they dreaded, they also divorced God's statues. Amen. Judgments and his moral law. Today, because the church is no longer involved in government, some of the laws and policies that have come to be are drastically against the moral laws, statuses and judgments that God gave us. The current state of America morally was forever changed the day they decided to separate the state from the church. The change in the institution of marriage is a prime example of how the separation of church from state from church affected the nation. And he's right here, and we're going to talk more about it, especially tomorrow, because you have to ask the question, what were we together, but yet we were not. In the sense, we were always divided. But if you notice from that early soundbite that said that the people were very religious, our leaders were not, but the people were, and they are the ones. If it's for the people, by the people, of the people, and they are the ones who put representatives in office. So you would think there should never have been a separation of church and state. If I'm a Christian, and this is a Christian nation, and I'm voting Christians into office to represent me, how is it possible that we have so many non-Christians in office today? If this is a Christian nation, how is that possible when we have more Christians than any other religion, any other denomination or whatever you want to call it in America? How is that possible that our representatives, when we put in office, are not representing us morally? Or there would not be same-sex marriage. There would not be the immoral acts of even the abortion rights and all of the rights that are in. See, we do immoral acts, but when you put them in the laws of the government, then you have another situation here. That means the government itself is sanctioning and agreeing with the immorality. You get what I'm saying? Yes. Because when they told the Indians, you got to go, that was an immoral thing. They were here first. Columbus didn't discover America. He discovered that somebody was already here. Look at what happened in World War II. Our President Roosevelt took the Japanese American citizens and put them in camps and removed them from society. It was this justice to those people. Because they looked Japanese, they had to go because Japan had just bombed Pearl Harbor. Okay, history is just repeating itself. We have if I'm a black man, and if I'm driving while black, I'll get pulled over. That's just the way of the beast. Okay, of our nation. Who did this? Who caused all this to happen? So I just read the Declaration of Independence, and you heard some of the language that's in there. Okay. And here I wanted to kind of talk about this so-called this more perfect union that's in the I think it's in the preamble maybe the federal convention convened in the state house the Independence Hall for those of you who know nothing about your history in Philadelphia okay on May 14, 1787 okay there's two dates that y'all need to have in your mind. Y'all keep thinking 1776 started everything and ended everything. I'm sorry. So May 14, 1787, they came together to revise the Articles of Confederation because the delegations from only two states were at first present. The members, they had adjourned from day to day until a quorum of seven states was obtained in May 25. So through discussion and debate, it became clear by mid-June that rather than amend the existing articles, the convention would draft an entirely new frame of government. Great idea, right? All through the summer, in closed sessions, the delegates debated and redrafted the articles of this new constitution. Among the chief points at issue were how much power to allow the central government, how many representatives in Congress to allow each state, and how these representatives should be elected directly by the people or by the state legislators. The work of the many minds, the Constitution stands as a model of cooperative statesmanship and an art of compromise. And again, I like the Constitution. I do. I think it needs to be reevaluated, but I like the Constitution. We have so many people fighting over it on how to interpret it, just like we do the Bible. All right. I don't think the Bible should be changed, but that's the Bible. That's something totally different. But the United States Constitution established America's national government and fundamental laws and guaranteed certain basic rights for its citizens. It was signed on September 17, 1787, because there's a lot of sevens in there, by delegates to the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia, presided over by George Washington, the king. I'm glad he has some morals to say, I will not be king. Under America's first governing document, the Articles of Confederation, the national government was weak and states operated like independent countries. It did. And it was weak. And at the 1887 convention, delegates devised a plan for a stronger federal government with three branches. Okay, the executive, that's the guy in the big house, the legislative, those mini guys in the house, and then the judicial, that's the guy with a robe on. Okay, well, at least 12 of them, along with a system of checks and balances to ensure no single branch would have too much power. It's a great system. A setup system. The Bill of Rights, 10 amendments, guaranteeing basic individual protections such as freedom of speech and religion, became part of the Constitution in 1791. All right, so y'all got 3 dates that I just gave you: 1776, 1787, 1791. A lot of stuff was happening in the 1700s. So today there have been a total of about 27 constitutional amendments. All right, in walked the preamble to the Constitution. Kicked off by saying, "We the people, in order to form a more perfect union." Why was those words used? Because of the chaos that was happening in what I just pre-read. Establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility. And I'm going out of my head. I think it's provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, secure the blessings of liberty to ourselves and to our posterity, do ordain and establish this Constitution. Again, Jesus ain't nowhere in that document. Mm-hmm. All right. It is a secular document. It is a political document. It is for the rights of all people, no matter what you believe in. Okay. So to say that this is a Christian nation, you got to go to the original document to find out what is it about us that we're Christians. Now, doesn't mean that we didn't change. For instance, many of you celebrate Christmas. You don't know the origins. You just look at Jesus being born. But you don't see some of the paganistic practices in both Easter and Christmas.
Like a tree and a bun.
But you said, well, we changed that. Okay, and that's your defense. So as far as this being a Christian nation, it changed. Some things did change. The document wasn't very Christian. But the people in it was very Christian. Just because the founders were not, the people were. And God allowed the document to happen because it did not bring tyranny to us or bondage to the people like from where they came from over there in Great Britain. I hope this is making some sense to you. So here goes a more perfect way. Matter of fact, in the Bible, if you go to Acts chapter 18, there's a guy who pops up by the name of Apollos. Acts chapter 18 and verse 24 says, "And a certain Jew named Apollos, born in Alexandria, an eloquent man and mighty in scriptures, came to Ephesus." The brother was bad. Man, he knew the scriptures up and down. This man was instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in the spirit, he spake and taught diligently the things of the Lord, knowing only the baptism of John. You see that? He was great in scripture. He knew it, but he only knew the baptism of John. He didn't know Christ that great. And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue. This is the Constitution, y'all. Whom, when Aquila and Priscilla had heard, they took him unto them and expounded unto him the way of God more perfectly. Now, that'll preach right there. You have these men of God who penned this document. Oh, they knew their language. You see how poetic the language was in the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution and what have you. But then somebody needed to show somebody a more perfect way. So they even thought to add it in their language. We the people in order to form a more perfect union. The First Amendment guarantees freedom concerning religion, expression, and assembly, and the right to petition. Thank God for them, the First Amendment. that these men who were not saved, but they had tolerance for whatever your religion was. Okay, it seemed like I'm bipolar, isn't it? No, not. It forbids Congress from both promoting one religion over others. This is so vitally important. And also restricting an individual's religion's practice. It guarantees freedom of expression by prohibiting Congress from restricting the press or the rights of individuals to speak freely. It also guarantees the right of citizens to assemble peaceably and to petition of the government. Okay, that's the First Amendment. Matter of fact, I'll read it. Congress shall make no law respecting and establishing of religion, or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press, or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. I don't want the government to tell me what the religion of the day is going to be. That's basically what they're saying here. Congress has, they can't make no law to say, all right, it's going to be a Christian nation, I don't care what y'all say, or it's going to be a Muslim nation, I don't care what y'all believe, this is what it's going to be. And the conquistadors came way back in the 1600s to try to tell those who are the Pueblo Indians, this is going to be the way of life. I'm coming to your territory and bringing my Catholic ways, and you will conform or we're going to kill you. And that's what the conquistadors did to the Pueblo Indians. They began to wipe them out because they says we're going to change what this territory of belief is going to be, and we're going to murder you. And again, some of you don't know your beginnings, and that's the beginning. That's why the Native Americans don't like, they don't, anyway. So, a Federalist is someone who supports a strong centralized government. That's the brother, that we want to bring out in just a minute here. Before I bring that out though, because, again, I want to talk about this whole thing about separation of church, and state. And matter of fact, there is a brother who's under fire. His name is, David Barton. Okay. He's from Wall Builders. I don't always agree with him. He says, in 1947, in the case of Everson versus Board of Education, the Supreme Court declared the First Amendment has erected a wall between church and state. That wall must be kept high and impregnable. We could not approve the slightest breach. The separation of church and state phrase, which they invoked and which has today became so familiar, was taken from an exchange of letters between President Thomas Jefferson and the Baptist Association of Danbury, Connecticut, shortly after Jefferson became the president. The election of Jefferson, America's first anti-federalist president, elated many Baptists since that denomination, by and large, was also strongly anti-federalist. Now you're saying, so what is a Federalist? A Federalist is someone who supports a strong centralized government. Okay. Back around the time of the Revolutionary War was being waged, the Constitution Convention was taking place. As I mentioned, there were legislators who were in favor of a strong centralized government, the Federalists, and there were those who were in favor of a limited federal government held accountable by their territories, or called anti-Federalists. So the Federalists were John Hancock, Alexander Hamilton, a mighty man, Hamilton from New York. Okay, y'all know him. John Jay from New York, George Washington from Virginia, and John Adams from Massachusetts. Anti-Federalists opposed, they opposed it because some people wanted to ratify the Constitution, as it did not constrain the federal government from abusing its power. Therefore, the Bill of Rights was constructed, okay? So we have to go further into the Federalists. So we talked about the election of Jefferson. Okay, an anti-Federalist. All right. Consequently, now having a president who not only had championed the rights of Baptists in Virginia, but who also had advocated clear limits on the centralized government powers. The Danbury Baptists wrote Jefferson a letter of praise and on October 7, 1801, telling him this. And this is where the separation of church and state come from, y'all. It's not in the Constitution. They says, among the many millions in America and Europe who rejoice in your election to the office, we embrace the first opportunity to express our great satisfaction in your appointment to the chief magistrate in the United States. We have reason to believe that America's God has raised you up. Notice it said America's God has raised you up to fill the chair of state out of that goodwill which he bears to the millions which you preside over. May God strengthen you for the arduous task which providence and the voice of the people have called you. And may the Lord preserve you safe from every evil and bring you at least to his heavenly kingdom through Jesus Christ, our glorious mediator. Now that was wishful thinking. Okay. Because we know what Jefferson was. I told y'all earlier. However, in that same letter of congratulations, the Baptists also expressed to Jefferson their grave concern over the entire concept of the First Amendment, including of its guarantee for the free exercise of religion. Here they say, it said, our sentiments are uniformly on the side of religion, religious liberty, that religious is at all times and places a matter between God and individuals, that no man ought to suffer in name personal effects on account of his religious opinion. Okay, and that the legitimate power of civil government extends no further than to punish the man who work ill to his neighbor. But, sir, our constitution of government is not specific. Therefore, what religious privilege we enjoy as a minor part of the state, we enjoy as favors granted and not as inalienable rights. Okay, this is the whole evident or the meaning all the grievances people had in the signing of the Declaration of Independence. Because when they signed the Declaration of Independence, the people says, okay, now what are we going to do? What are we independent of or from? And we're declaring what? So that they began to look at their neighbor from different states and say, okay, what are we going to do now? And that's what these Baptists are saying here. So in short, the inclusion of protection for the free exercise of religion in the Constitution suggested to the Danbury Baptists that the rights of religious expression was government given, thus alienable rather than God given, hence inalienable. You got it? And that therefore the government might someday attempt to regulate religious expression. This was possibility to which they strenuously objected, unless, as they had explained, someone's religious practice caused him to work ill to his neighbor. Jefferson understood their concern. It was also his own. In fact, he made numerous declarations about the Constitution's inability of the federal government to regulate or restrict or interfere with religious expression. Okay? And he began to talk about it. Jefferson believed that the government was to be powerless to interfere with religious expression for a very simple reason. He had long witnessed the unhealthy tendency of government to encroach upon the free exercise of religion, as he explains in the letter to Noah. Noah Webster. Okay. Thomas Jefferson had no intentions of allowing the government to limit or restrict or regulate or interfere with public religious practices. Okay. Thank God for that. He may not have been a man of God, but he did not want the government to interfere. They just come from that mess. He believed, along with the other founders, that the First Amendment had been enacted only to prevent the federal establishment of a natural denomination. A fact he made clear in a letter to fellow signers of the Declaration of Independence, Benjamin Rush. And this is where these statements come from. Jefferson had committed himself as president to pursuing the purpose of the First Amendment, preventing the establishment of a particular form of Christianity by the Episcopalians, the Congregationalists, or any other denomination, Kojic, Apostolic. since this was Jefferson's view concerning religious expression, In his short and polite reply to the Danbury Baptists on January 1, 1802, he assured them that they need not fear that the free exercise of religion would never be interfered, which by the government, the federal government, as he explained. And he mentioned, then he starts saying, gentlemen, the affectionate sentiments of esteem and approbation which you are so good as to express towards me on behalf of the Danbury Baptist Association gives me the highest satisfaction. And he began to talk like the Apostle Paul in his salutations and in his letters. Okay. And we understand now the whole thing about separation of church and state. Okay. And that's what it all bears down to. Okay. Again, we're going to do a part two tomorrow, but I want to move into some of the ways that America has turned into, and to figure out what happened to us, the church, and why is it that the world how we allow these particular terms and the attributes of these terms to come in. and I'm going to break down about five or six of them. Secularization, anti-supernationalism, religious pluralism, political correctness, humanism, and the gospel of inclusion. All of these, I want to break them down. But I want to first start with Oprah Winfrey. Okay? I have a file here, and it's probably going to go into the break, but it's a file called, I'm calling Oprah Winfrey's Professing Jesus Christ. All right? That's the name of the file, and I found it on YouTube. It says, Oprah Winfrey professes Jesus Christ, but you, if you notice and listen to her very closely, she never wants to mention his name. Go for it.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Oprah.
So far in life class, we have learned how to stop the pain, Missy Yanla, how to live fearlessly, Tony Robbins, and to tap into our life's purpose. Tonight, we're taking a chance as we tap into our spiritual side. Anybody know what their spiritual side is? That's good. I am not talking about religion. I am not talking about religion. I am a Christian. That is my faith. I'm not asking you to be a Christian. If you want to be one, I can show you how. But it is not required. I have respect for all faiths. All faiths. But what I'm talking about is not faith or religion. I'm talking about spirituality. So I want to get clear on what I mean by that. It means, my definition is, living your life with an open heart through love. Living your life with an open heart. Allowing yourself to align with the values of tolerance, acceptance, of harmony, of cooperation, and reverence for life. Life. Now, there is a force, energy, consciousness, divine thread, I believe, that connects all spiritually to all of us, to something greater than ourselves. Now, if you're living in the space of an open heart, you have a blessed life. Anybody know what I'm talking about? If you are living in the space of an open heart, you have a blessed life. And I believe that there is no life without a spiritual life. I want to say that again. There is no life without a spiritual life, because we are all spiritual beings having a human experience. So are you ready to open your heart? Are you ready? Are you ready to allow abundance and blessings? People can't figure out how I got to be so successful. It is because I have lived in the space of spirit my whole life. My favorite Bible verse, because I am Christian, is Acts something. I used to note it a number, but it's an Acts. Y'all can Google it. But it says, thank you, 1728. In God I live and move and have my being. I live and move and have my being. And you want to know why I am really so successful? I knew that at 4 years old.
Yep, that's, we're going to do a show called The Church of Oprah Winfrey. Get ready for that show, because she has many, many, many members of her church. She is their apostle, and many of you, well, I want to hear Thomas Whitfield before I go there. He's proclaiming a wonderful word here. We need a word from the Lord. Sir Walter Jones Show.
Wow. log on to urbanbroadcastmedia.com and check out the many services Urban Broadcast Media provides. Whether it's social media, video production, radio broadcasting, or audio recording, we got you covered.
Hey, this is Julie Norwood with 60 seconds of cool inspiration for your day. In life, it's really easy to get bogged down. We get bogged down because we forget we're on a journey to see our Father. What you see is not where you belong. Look to heaven. Remember heaven. Keep heaven right in front of you. This will help you keep everything in perspective. This life is temporary, even in the ministry. This is not your home. Remember that. Your battles won't be such a big deal when you know that where you are is not where you belong for any longer than a season. Embrace where you are for a greater purpose. Embrace this life and all that it affords you, an expectation of heaven. That's 60 seconds of cool inspiration with Julie Norwood. For more inspiration, check out my webpage, julienorwood.com. God loves you, and He has an awesome plan for your life.
Great, Ray. That's a wrap.
Huh?
Yes!
Sweet.
Hey, how about a movie tonight, huh?
Wow, what's that aftershave you're wearing?
You high karate aftershave is so powerful, it drives women right out of their minds. That's why we have to put instructions on self-defense in every package. High karate, the brisk splash-on aftershave that smooths and soothes and cools. High karate, aftershave, cologne, and gift sets. High karate. Be careful how you use it.
You don't need another political uprising. We don't need another conqueror on the scene. What we need is a special word that will burn within our hearts and give us direction. From above, we need a word from the Lord. A word Just one word from the Lord will move all the doubts and cause the sun to shine and give peace of mind. Speak, Lord. Our wisdom and our understanding. Though we lack the very love you show in the sun. Lord, we walk to the end of that ways and we stand so much to gain. So give us your word, Lord. Speak, Lord. Just one word from the Lord will move all the doubts and cause the sun to shine and give a peace of mind. Speak, Lord. Speak. Lord will remove all the doubts and cause the sun to shine and give a peace of mind. Speak, Lord. Speak, Lord.
The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
The Word of God is powerful, often misunderstood, but with proper study, you can gain accurate application of this potent source of life here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
If I were you, I would say,
Thursday.
Speak, Lord.
We need a word from the Lord.
Speak, Lord.
Oh, speak to me. When we went to break, we were listening to Oprah Winfrey preach to her thousands of members. And the purpose of me bringing that up is because I want to talk about how someone like her and many of you have fallen victim to the different styles of running away from God. First one here I'm going to bring out is called secularization. Secularization. Is that it's that epical process by which people have gone from living in a world suffused with the sacred to living in a world in which sacred meanings have been largely drained away. That's pretty much Oprahism, secularization. That means it's okay to mention God a couple times in your life, but he's not the center of your, like that Richard Smallwood. Jesus, the center of my joy. Oh. That, yeah. Then we're going to supernaturalism. Not super, but supranationalism. It's a type of multinational political union where the negotiated power is delegated to an authority by governments of member states. Basically, it's the European Union. It's the EU. And we're living actually in that now. The United States is not its own entity. Believe it or not, China owns us. I need you to right now go in your house and turn over everything you see and look under. What does it say? It says made in China. They own a lot of our buildings. They own our corporations. They own us. Okay, so if something happens to us, something happens to the entire world. Yeah. Yeah, there you go. Used to be Taiwan. That's right. That's right. Number three, religious pluralism is an attitude or policy regarding the diversity of religious belief systems coexisting in society. It can indicate one or more of the following, as the name of the world view according to which one's religion is not the sole and exclusive source of truth. And it goes on and on. I don't have time to go into it, but we know what religious pluralism is. You guys are part of these ecumenical services. I tell you, I need you to be very careful. Be very careful. A lot of you, whether you're apostolic or Kojic or Baptist, and you join forces with Muslims and Eastern Orthodox stuff and what have you, and y'all come together and y'all all in a pulpit together, and he say one thing, he said, that's ecumenical. You got to be careful of this, okay? God did not design this to be, and he got with the Jews. He spanked the Jews for this same stuff. Number four, political correctness. We already know what that is. Y'all can't say what you used to say before. And so you're allowing other little tolerance things come in. Number five, humanism. Humanism, y'all worshiping yourself. Again, this is Oprahism. An outlook of or system of thought attaching prime importance to humans rather than a divine supernatural matter. So you physician, heal yourself. That's pretty much what that humanism is to me. Then comes the gospel of inclusion. We know who that's from. It is in a ridiculous doctrine. That means no matter what you do, you're going to get in no matter what. A universalism. Some of our leaders were Unitarians, our presidents. Okay. No matter what, you getting in. It is confusion. And this is, that's why I played over, because she has, she's one of the apostles of all of these religions. Notice on stage, she never mentioned, she said she's a Christian. That's a safe word to use. Everybody's a Christian. It's very safe to say, but you will not hear the name Jesus Christ, because that name, it brings you to another place. It separates you and puts you into another box that you don't want to be in, because you're afraid of the backlash. Okay, now I have a file called Play Confused Gay. Okay, and the reason why I brought Oprah in here, I brought you into all these other terms and their meanings, is because when you get all of this mess into one person, you'll get this mess I'm getting ready to play now. I played this on a show called the Gay Agenda in America, or something like that. Okay, you're gonna get this type of reasoning right here. Go ahead, play that right quick.
People think I'm gay. I'm not gay. I'm not gay. I don't be on no gay. I'm a lesbian. Gay is when two studs. What you mean? Like, that's gay as two studs for each other? Like, really? Really? Like, y'all going past gay. Like, y'all going extremely gay. Y'all going too gay. Like, I don't know. Like, y'all really, like, literally jumped over the rainbow and just got stuck on some gay. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's like double sinning. It's already a sin when you're a lesbian, which I am. Everybody sin. God died for our sins. That's what it says. God didn't die to double sin for us to double sin. You know what I'm saying? I play that lesbian, but that gay killed me with that. I don't be on that. Like, straight world probably confused. Like, okay. Like, for instance, you straight, right? You and your nigga been before marriage. Most of y'all, not everybody. You know what I'm saying? That's a sin. You're before marriage. You sinning already. But that's a normal sin. You know what I'm saying? Not saying you allowed to do that, but it's just normal. It's a normal sin. It's a common sin. But if you go and double sin, like you trifling, like I hope you catch something. Double sinning is when you go multiple niggas. Like, you got a nigga and you going around the corner to go multiple niggas. That's double sinning. If you're going to sin, you sin the right way, not the wrong way. I'm sinning the right way. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I know I'm gay. That's a sin. And I go, you know what I'm saying, a few say other what? Gay, they film. I'm going, but guess what? I'm sinning the right way. I would never double sin. I would never go and go to the other side. Like, they went to the other side of the rainbow. I'm not with that. Like, that's double sinning. You know what I'm saying? Miss me with that. Know the difference between gay, lesbian, sin, and double sin. I know my difference.
She know her difference. Okay, again, this is the confusion that has happened in America. Now, she's the extreme, but you will be surprised how many thousands of people feel the way she do. I've talked to them myself, and they says, God know my heart. Yes, he does. Your heart is wicked. He said, who can know it? Yeah, he said, I sure do know your heart. And so you guys got caught in this gospel of inclusion, humanism, religious pluralism, and this is the mess that it has birthed, this seed, which you just heard. Let's go to The View. These are the ladies from The View. Whoopi Goldberg, Nicole Wallace, Rosie Perez, Rosie O'Donnell, Raven Simone. Listen to how they speak about who they believe in. The View.
I think one of the reasons that Christianity has kind of lost its way is that Christians have lost their way. And I can say this, I stumbled, you know, a lot earlier in my life, and I stumble on a daily basis, but we're forgetting the principle. You know, they will know that you are Christians by your love for one another. And that's what it's about. And that's what a lot of Christians are forgetting to do.
But maybe it could also be that the world is changing. I mean, every religion has its time and place, pagan and other things.
Right.
And then we start evolving as a people, as humans.
Right.
And people start having other views of what's going on. Me personally, I'm all about energy. I'm all about light. I'm all about new age. I have a personal rejection to religion itself, but spirituality is through everybody, no matter what God you
right.
praise to.
Well, I think it goes back to what you said.
I think it goes back to something that you said yesterday
about no labels. I think that
I don't think it's just a younger generation, but I also think it's my generation and older. I think we're coming to a place where we don't want to be labeled this religion or that religion, but it does not mean we do not believe.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, and I think it's a big thing.
Tony, so,
your preacher's
daughter. Well, you know, I'm a PK. I'm a preacher's kid. So for me growing up, religion was very important. But as I've gotten older, I'm understanding that it's my personal relationship.
Yes.
So it becomes more spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of times in church, they don't talk about the personal relationship you should have with God. It's like a group of people mm-hmm. deciding this is the way we're going to serve God. So it becomes a religion, sometimes
so,
a cult.
So like, when people ask you, are you religious? What do you say?
I am a Christian.
Yep.
But I'm more spiritual.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. personal relationship. She started off right. She started off good. And then what happens is if you got more people in the room and you by yourself, you get tricked up. And they were about four of the ladies on there. I know Rosie wasn't there, in a couple, but these are the ones who were on The View. I don't know who's on it now. But this is the problem that we're in. Notice the terms: energy, life, new age, tolerance. Okay, light, I'm sorry. All right, these are terms that you have to watch out for. These are the same type of terms that's in the Declaration of Independence, and you will see them in parts of the Constitution. Look out for them, because, again, these are decon rat poison terms, okay? Oprah uses, she says, you don't have, she said, notice in her spiel, she says, being a Christian is not required. Did you hear that? She said it's not required. Okay, so this is, again, all the terms I keep bringing up to you guys. This last file I'm going to try to play because I got to get out of here. President Dwight Eisenhower gave a farewell speech, and he pretty much kind of prophesied about the military establishment that they were heading into at that time. See if we can bring that up.
My fellow Americans. This evening, I come to you with a message of leave-taking and farewell, and to share a few final thoughts with you, my countrymen. We have been compelled to create a permanent armaments industry of vast proportions. 3.5 million men and women are directly engaged in the defense establishment. The total influence, economic, political, even spiritual, is felt in every city, every state house, every office of the federal government. We recognize the imperative need for this development, yet we must not fail to comprehend its grave implications. In the councils of government, we must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex. The potential for the disastrous rise of misplaced power exists and will persist.
You have to realize this is one of the great presidents, great military leaders. On his way out the door, at the end of his second term, he says, by the way, watch out for the military-industrial complex.
People know that he invented the phrase military-industrial complex, but very rarely do you see the whole thing and realize how utterly strident his warning was. I think it's one of the most profound statements ever made by an American president.
Just like George Washington gave his warnings about foreign entanglements and things like that, my dad was giving his warning against letting this military-industrial complex get out of hand.
We must never let the weight of this combination endanger our liberties or democratic processes.
A vital element in keeping the peace is our military establishment, is what he's saying here. Our arms must be mighty, ready to instant action so that no potential aggressor may be tempted to risk his own destruction. This conjunction of an immense military establishment and a large arms industry is new in the American experience. Very, very profound words. Reason why it's profound, because the United States spends more on defense than the next seven countries combined. Germany, India, United Kingdom, France, Saudi Arabia, Russia, and China all combined total about $601 billion in defense spending combined. You know what the United States spending is by themselves? $610 billion. We spent more on military than all of these nations combined. These are very powerful nations, okay? Why is that? We can talk about that tomorrow. because we're going to go there. Why is it that we have to spend so much money to protect our freedom? This is some stuff that we have to get into eschatology in order to really properly to define what it is. Okay, I'm going to read the scripture and I'm going to kind of get out of here early. I got church tonight and Dion got school and y'all got lives too. At least that's what y'all are telling me. Tomorrow we're going to go into Romans 13. We're going to talk about the laws, obeying the laws of the land and the laws of God. But 1 Timothy chapter 2 says, I exhort therefore that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. For kings, that means presidents, y'all, in Congress and senators, okay, and mayors and governors. For kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all goodliness, godliness, and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved. He wants them to be saved and to come into the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and man, and that man is Jesus Christ, who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. We have to pray for all of our leaders, no matter what, so that we might live peaceably with them. Is this a Christian nation? It could be. It could have been. Unfortunately, there's little pockets of Christianity in this nation. But as a whole, no, I don't believe we're a Christian nation, because you rarely will ever hear the name Jesus Christ mentioned in any of the annals of the halls of nowhere. All right. Let's talk more about it tomorrow. OK, God, we love you. Thank you for today's show and allowing us to speak the word of God and to bring truth to mankind. Pray for us, God. We pray for the nation that is. We pray for the nation that you might hear our prayers and that you might adhere to it. You said that you will heal our land if our people that are called by your name would just humble ourselves and turn and just repent. We repent this day on behalf of this nation and that we might return back to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Tomorrow's Fireside Friday. We're going to talk about some more stuff, part two. Thank you, Jay, for giving us this wonderful topic. Go to Spreaker.com. Sir Walter Jones Show.
You've been listening to the Sir Walter Jones Radio Show, where he provides you with a biblical perspective for your everyday life. Stay connected to Sir Walter Jones by visiting him online at www.sirwalterjones.com or on Facebook at www.facebook.com/The Sir Walter Jones Show. Stay tuned until next time with The Sir Walter Jones Show with Sir Walter Jones.
If you can't find any work, I'll put in a good word for you at my job, man.
You ain't got no job, man!
Yeah, one more time. Randy Watson, how about it?
And now we take great pleasure in presenting to you the star of our program, Miss Kate Smith.
Hello, everybody. It is my happy privilege to introduce a new song, God Bless America.
While the storm clouds gather far across the sea, let us swear allegiance. Grateful for a land so fair. As we raise our voices in a solemn prayer, God bless America, land that I love.
Don't be late.
No.
Quiet with God. God bless America. My home. Sweet.
Right, Pop? Right, son.
Makes you think of Blake, doesn't it? Makes you think of a lot of things. We're going to be in this yet, Mom.
Darling.
New song?
Brand new, first time in the year.
Brand new, my eye.
You know, I threw that song out of Yip Yip Yap Hank 22 years ago. Sounds better now.